Good evening, everyone. Myself Santa Kumar, and I'm a CISO of Connor MEP, and I'm a technical lead in HCL. So today we are going to see the third session of our Microsoft Graph API. So it's a deep. Previously we have saw two sessions. One is basics, and another one is how to create a Node.js application using Microsoft Graph. And today we are going to see how to authenticate and how we get authorization in Microsoft Graph API and how we can access the resources from the Microsoft Cloud entity. So you can follow me on me on KTS Kumar at any handle, any social handle. Okay. So we'll move on to our agenda first. So first, we are going to see the authentication. What are the authentication works? Then we'll see what are the different permission types available in Microsoft Graph API. And third, we'll see what is different type of authorization is available in Microsoft Graph to access the different resources. Okay, and then we'll see the endpoints and how we get get authorized to Microsoft Cloud and how we can get the access token and all. At last, we'll see the demo and then we'll have a Q&A session. Okay, so in our previous, previous session, we have seen that how to create a Node.js application using the Microsoft Graph API. So I'll just recap once again that one. Okay. So I'm going to just. So this is what we have built on previous session. So this is a Node.js application and we have to connect to Microsoft Graph. So you have to click on that connect button. Then it will ask us to log in. Is it audible to everyone?
Yes, Santa Kumar.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Savanan. So someone has sent and there is no voice. Okay. So okay, this is what and this is what we have created in our previous session. That is, this is a normal home page, and if you click on that users, it will list out all what are the users available in Azure AD. And if you click on this send email, it will if we can give you any email ID and click on send mail, it will send a mail to all whoever user we have entered in text box. And this SharePoint, which lists out all the SharePoint sites available in Office 365, including site collections, subsites, and all the subsites. And the next one is teams. What are the teams available, team channels available in Microsoft Graph? So this is what we have created earlier. Okay. So and today we are going to see how we can, because now in previous session we have seen how we can, what are the resources, what are the endpoints we have to use to get this information. But today we are going to how we can authenticate, what library is used to authenticate to get these resources. Okay. So moving back to our slide, okay. So how we can authenticate Microsoft Graph? First, how does app authenticate? First of all, we have to authenticate the app, then only we can get the resources. Okay, so we should need access token. We should get access token from the Microsoft Azure AD. Then only the app should authenticate the resources. Resources means nothing but the user sites, emails, those are all resources. Okay, so to get these resources we should need access token, and this access token we have to get this from Azure AD. Okay, next one is, what is access token? Access token is nothing but encrypted encoded JSON format. Okay, this what is used by Azure AD, and in the format of base 64 encoded JSON web tokens. Okay, because this JSON web tokens which contains the information about your app. App means what is the client ID of app, and what are the permissions required to access this access the information, and what are the API you are going to send to the server. So these are the informations which is contained in the access token in a encoded JSON format. Next one is how to get access token. First of all, we have to get this access token from the Azure AD. Okay, first we have to, from the application, we have to send the request to authorization server, and the authorization server which validates our request, and then it will authenticate Azure, it will validate. After validation, it will send us the that access token. Okay, this was authorized by user. Once validated means, first it will validate with the authorization server, and also what are the in the request itself we have to send the permission also. So it also validate the user and the permissions with the authorization server and send us the access token. By using this access token only we can able to get the information from the Microsoft cloud services. Okay, now we'll see what is the basis, that OAuth basics information, how the OAuth is works. Okay, first one, here we have four type of entity. One is resource, that is us. Resource owner is end user, is us, and OAuth client is our machine, client machine. This whatever machine we are using, and the next one is authorization server. Authorization server is nothing but the Azure AD, Azure AD kind of server. Okay, that because this will contain the Azure AD information, and another one is resource server, where all the information is stored. Because the resource server is nothing, it's not a single server, it will spread across the globe. Okay, so now first resource owner which accesses the services from the browser, that's what client. This then that and then it will. First, we have to, that is, with accessing the browser, we also send the permission information also. So, what kind of data, what kind of permission the current user has. So, that access we have to send to authorization server, and then this authorization server which is validated with resources server, this whether because I'm going to access the one-way information of my different user. Okay, so for example, so I'm going to access another user files from the OneDrive. So that permission information we have to send it via this request. Okay, and this authorization server which validates whether this user has access to the another person files, so that it is validated with resource server. Once the resource server which gives you the success or the success status, it will send the issue token, send the access token to the client, access token to the browser. Okay, once we get the access token, we have to send this access token information with the BA token in the HTTP header request header. And we have to set this access token in the header of that HTTP request, and that will send to resource server. And based on this, the resource server will return you the exact resource information. This is what the OAuth basics. Okay, the same OAuth basics is Microsoft Graph API is also following. That's what I am coming to see. Okay, next one is after the authentication, There, I said, I told, we have to send the permission information in the request. So, okay. So, as per request, as per permission, there are two types of permissions available in Microsoft Graph API. One is delegated permissions, okay, and another one is application permission. Okay, the delegated permission, whatever application you are using, which is run on behalf of the signed in user. Okay, the application which runs on whatever permission is had by the sign in user, the application which run as the same the current user permissions. That's what the user permissions delegated to the application. So the application is run behalf of the user. But the application permission, this is a get access as a services or service. Okay, so this is not run on behalf of the user. It will there is no need to log in. This application permission means there is no need to log in. There is an admin, it directly takes the admin privilege and runs this application. Okay, previously in previous sessions I told delegated permissions, which is the applications like web application or the native, or that is mobile application. That's what these are applications is used by delegated permissions. But application permissions we should require in running the timer jobs or services. So there, for running the timer services, for running the services, timer jobs or services, we should not need to log in as a user. So it's by default it's gets that access as an admin and runs in the back end. Okay, and next one is who can consent, that is who will approve this permission. Because this here in the delegated permissions, any user or admin will provide the approval to the app, so that app can run behalf of that user. Okay, for example, whether a simple application which has the both kind of permission, admin level permission, that is the application which has a code which to read my files from the OneDrive, and also it has the feature to read files from another user's OneDrive. Okay, so if that particular signed in user has an admin permission, he can able to read the files from another user's OneDrive. Otherwise, the signed in user only able to see his own files from the OneDrive. So this is what the permissions will be approved by the user. Some permissions is we required approved from admin side. But in application permission, application permission app, there is only one option, only admin only provide approval to run this application. And another is mobile, web or single page app can be created these are applications is using the delegated permissions. Okay, that's what apps that runs with a user present. User should log in to access this application. But in application permissions, apps that run without a user, there is no need to log in as a user to run this application permission apps. So, any questions? No, okay. Okay, and so far we have saw the permissions. Okay, but in the Microsoft Graph request, Graph API request, we have to send the permission in a different three separate words. One is, this is called permission scope, resource, operation, constraint. Resource means whatever the user or site, your site from the SharePoint or files from the OneDrive or SharePoint or Teams from the Microsoft Teams, like that. Operation is nothing but read write. So these are all operation. And constraint is the constraint is the optional one. So we know for normal user applications, there is no need to use a constraint. So if you want to provide admin level kind of access to the application, we should add this is all constrained to the permission scope. That's what files.read.all, which this permission scope enables the app to read all users OneDrive or all users all files from the SharePoint site or all files from the all users OneDrive. This files.read, this is will be run across the organization. This user.read, which returns you the current user profile information. That's it. If you use user.read.all, then the application will read all user information from all across the organization. Okay, so far we saw that the permission information. Now we'll see the Azure AD versus Azure AD v2.0. okay, so in previous before, maybe 1 year before, the Microsoft Graph, which uses the Azure AD for the authentication, for getting the access token. Okay, nowadays the Microsoft Graph is using Azure AD v2.0 as for authorization or for getting the access token. Okay, so there are two, Azure AD and Azure AD v2.0. so Azure AD, which supports only work or school account. So maybe I'm working in HL, so I can this Azure AD will provide authorization to only the organization account or school account. But Azure AD v2.0, which supports the organization account and also to the Microsoft accounts like outlook.com or live.com. so it will also enables to use the consumer type, not only the organization, not only the organizations. Next one is, this Azure AD will has a static consent. Consent means nothing but the permission. So whenever if you are creating the application which using the Azure AD authentication, by initial stage, by initial before running the application itself, we have to provide the permission information, whatever the user.read or files.read.all, whatever the permission scope is there, we have to provide in before starting the application. Okay, but in Azure AD v2.2, if even though the application is running, we can update the permission scope and run the rerun that application. This is the benefit from both. So next one is Azure AD. For each application, we should require a different application IDs. That is, we can get this application IDs from the app registration portal. Okay, but for Azure AD, we have to get it from Azure application registration portal. We have to get that ID. So for each, whatever application we have to create, we have to create a different application IDs for each different applications. But for Azure AD v2.0, we can create a single application ID and we can use this application ID in across any type of applications. So single application ID will be used for multiple applications, but for Azure AD we should require each different application IDs for different applications. So in this Azure AD, we have to get this the application ID from the Azure AD registration portal, but for Azure AD v2.0 we can get from Microsoft that application registration portal. So there are different portals is available for getting the application IDs for front one. So there's we have saw what are the different type of authorization Azure AD authentication. Now we will see what are the endpoints we have to pass to this Azure AD, and we have to get the access token. So first of all, nowadays the v2.0 is becoming familiar, so I'll going with the v2.0 endpoints. First one is login.microsoft.microsoftonline.com/tenant/oauth2/v2.0/authorize. This authorize, we have to use this authorize to first we have to pass some basic information about the application and what are the permission we have to get from that authorization server. So some basic information we have to set it in a header, and we have to pass this authorize to the authorization server. Okay, then based on that request, it will send us the ID code. First of all, it will not return the access token by default. first, if we send authorize, it will send some basic code ID. Okay, and then we have to pass this the slash token. Okay, once we send a slash token, it will return you the access token information. So after that only we can able to access the my resource from Microsoft Cloud. Okay, here in the tenant we are, I have highlighted the tenant in yellow color. So we have to replace this tenant with common or organization or consumers or tenant ID. Okay, so the common means which will be used for both the Microsoft normal Outlook account or Live account or organization account. Here if you use organizations, it will only used on organization account. Okay, that is if I'm working in HL, so I have to pass only the I can able to get only my HL user information if you use organization. But if you use common, I can able to get my Outlook account information also. But for the consumers, we have to, if we use the consumers, we can get the authorization or access token for my Outlook account or Live account. Okay, and then for tenant ID, if you pass a tenant ID for our Office XY, it will return you that organization related information. Next one is how I told we have to send the authorized endpoint first as a request, and based on that it will return you some code information as a response, and then we have to pass that code information to the authorization server once again for validation, and then only we can able to get the access token. Okay, so first of all, request, we have to pass get method, and then authorize, we have to pass scope is nothing but the permission. Okay, and response type as a code, we have to get the code, we have to get the information, that response information in the code parameter. And then next one is client ID, the application registration ID, application ID. This one is client is nothing but the application ID. Redirect URI. Redirect URI is nothing but the after getting the response, it will redirect to this URL, and then response mode as a query, and then response will be this code. It will return the response and the code parameter. So and then we have to pass this code value to the token endpoint. Here this login token, and then we have to pass this client ID and user ID, and then we have to pass the code information. You see here code equal to A, this one we have to pass once again, and then based on that we will get that access token. You see this is the access token. This is here if we add full access token here, it will take more spaces, so that I have just limited the access token here and some limited characters to the access token. Okay, this is what a get token. Then we have sent a request and authorize endpoint, and then we can get the access token from the token endpoint. Now we can call the Microsoft Graph, because now we have the access token. Here this is the endpoint graph.microsoft.com/v1.0/me. This is the endpoint to get my profile information, and in the request header we have to pass in the authorization bearer and access token. This is EYJ0, some junk character. This is the access token we have to pass in the request, and then we can get the response as below in the JSON format. You can see. So now we will see the demo in okay, what are the applications we can create by using the Microsoft Graph? Web apps, native apps, bots, background process. For delegated permissions will be used for web apps, native apps, bots, but for background process it should require yeah, application permissions. Okay, I have covered this slide many times in the previous two sessions, so I'm just moving to next one. So this is the mobile and native application authorization chart. Okay, first you can see from the application I can send this code, response type as code and client ID, application ID, and then it's sent to the authorize. From the authorize the user, that is in the sign in consent means it will pop up one prompt to provide the approval to that is we are providing the approval to the application to you to run as in behalf of the current user. So that's what sign in as consent. So I am providing the approval to the app to run behalf of myself. So and then I'm getting the after this validation is I'm getting the application getting the authorization code. Okay, from the authorization code we have to pass this to token and code to the token endpoint. Okay, it goes up to token endpoint and then the token endpoint returns you the access token. So the application passes this access token to the resource, the Microsoft as in the endpoint graph.microsoft.com, and then this returns the current user profile. So once the token expires, there is by default the authorized endpoint which returns also with the reference token. So we have to pass this reference token once again to the token endpoint, and then the token endpoint which sends you the referenced access token. So now we can pass this referenced access token to the resource and you can run the application as same as previous one. This is for running the native application thing. Now we can see the Java, how the JavaScript application authorization works. Okay, first the same as previous one. Okay, only thing is it's directly goes to graph.microsoft.com instead of token. Okay, this access response type and getting the approval from the user and reduce the access token, it goes to graph.microsoft.com and then application gets the current user profile. So same as that we have here, we should pass the reference token. Okay, and then access get the access token, then it pass to the endpoint and we get the current user profile. Okay, so for all of for not for we the token endpoint, so we have to use the token endpoint for some of the application, not for all applications. Okay, then this is a service applications, the application permission scope, this one. So the first we have to send the authorized endpoint and we have to pass this admin consent. Okay, in previous slide we saw only the user consent, but here in daemon application we have to get the admin consent. Admin should approve the app to run or fetch the application fetch the resources from the admin point of admin privileges. Okay, so this admin consent returns you the tenant ID and we have to pass this client ID secret with tenant ID and then we will get the access token. So we have to pass this access token to the with the graph endpoint and we can get all users in the application. So it's what by initially it gets difficult to understand. So if you work on each application, it's very easy to understand this one. So it's nothing but there are two endpoints mainly. One is authorized and another one is token. Okay, and after the token we have to pass the token endpoint which returns you the access token. We have to pass this access token with the graph endpoint, that is for graph.microsoft.com. so the graph endpoint which returns you the result. So this is what we are going to see in the demo. So this is we are going to create simple single page application. Okay, say demo. So here first one is this JavaScript SPA app which sends a sign in. Once we sign in, it get validated, it's going to Azure AD authorization, that is Azure AD v2 endpoint is the authorized endpoint, and from there it gets the ID token. Okay, and then sends to the application. So we have to send another one request with the token endpoint to the authorization server. Once the token is validated, it returns you the access token. Okay, and we got the SP application got the access token, and we have to send the request, the graph endpoint request plus access token to the graph API resource. So it returns you the response. Okay, so any questions? Oh, okay. So these are the references, you can just note it down. So this Microsoft Authentication Library for JS, which has here a library, which has here a framework for authenticating with Azure AD authorization server. And next below one is this, this is my GitHub account, GitHub sample. This is what we are going to see in the demo. So I have already uploaded a source to this location. You can just download and then you can run this npm npm install and then npm start. It will start the application in the localhost 2020. Okay, so we'll see the demo now. Okay, we have only this. Okay. So previously, so if you want to see, so this is my source we are going to see. So here has index.html and two script file. That's it. We are going to create in our application. So I'm going to just publish. So it's very small, I think. Let me increase this. Okay. Obviously, it's better. Okay, so we'll start create one project folder, JS graph demo. Sorry. So here we are going to create one simple application, JS graph demo 1.0, so as it is connecting. Our script application on endpoint is, we can leave as it is or we can create this one. And then this command as it is, git repository. You can give your name. Yeah, now. I will open this folder in our Visual Studio Code. Okay, we have a folder. So, how we can? Okay, let me. Okay, first we are going to. We have to create server.js. Okay, here this is what, and then source for that, and that index.html, and then scripts. Under the scripts, we are going to create config.js and then one graph helper. Okay, these are all the this is our structure. Okay, and first we'll have, okay, before that we have to create the application ID. Okay, so I forgot to create that one, so we'll move back to developer.microsoft.com. And then you can see, let me zoom this, my applications, click on this, my apps, we have to log in. So I have logged in to my apps, my application registration portal. Here I'm going to create add an app. JS graph demo app. This is our. You can also use guided setup to navigate to different options. So I'll show you that one. So create. And we have different type of application types. So we are going to create single page app. So I'm selecting this one. And JavaScript SPA start guided setup. So I've clicked this one, JavaScript SPA. So this will navigate to next. This picture we have saw in the slide. And if you want to more information, you can just expand and read. Something happened. Okay. Just set up. This has different, we have different libraries for different type of applications, for .NET Core, Node.js, for AngularJS application. For each one, we have different type of libraries. Okay, so this is the HTML code they have given. And then here we are not going to use their HTML. So we'll have a simple JavaScript and simple HTML and we can run this. So this is the authentication library methods. So you can also copy and paste in your HTML and then you can run the app. So here we are not going to use this. Configure. So we are going to pass 2020 as a redirect URI and client ID will be this one. So we have to note it down. Client ID. And redirect URL. Okay, so that's it. You have to use this one. So we have created the client ID and everything. So I'm just minimizing this one. So in the config.js, we have to add the client ID. So I'm creating application config. Client ID as this one. We have to pass some redirect URI and then interaction mode. That is for the getting the authentication. It will ask us to approve the app. That is the concern. It will open a permission concern pop up. So to mention that one. So I have already had this one. Just so here's anyone know how to zoom it? So I'm going to copy and paste this one. So we have a client ID, redirect URI, interaction mode, graph endpoint. This is the basic endpoint, first endpoint we are going to use, and the graph scopes, the what are the permissions. So once during the maybe after running the application also, we can update the graph scope and then recompile it and run once again. This is the dynamic concern. But in if you use AAuth 1.0, during the authorize endpoint itself, we have to pass the permission scope and we have to access. Afterwards, that is we couldn't be able to send it. Because that's what, and if you use AAuth 1.0 version, we have to specify the permission scope in the app registration portal itself. Okay, I'm just saving this one. So in the server.js, this is a default iExpress one. So we are going to use the iExpress npm for running this JavaScript in a localhost mode. So I'm going to use the server.js. Okay. So here we have to install in the packages, we have to use three packages we have to install as a dependency. One is Express, and another one is Morgan, and another one is Path. So to install this one, I'm going to terminal npm install Express, Morgan, and then Path. Oh, sorry. We have to install as a dependency. So this will get the package from the cloud and install it here. So this is one. So this is installed. So all the packages, dependency packages, installed under node modules folder. So in the config.js we have, server.js we have, and then we have to add a add our index.html. So by default in our slide I have sent you one reference, right? So this has a Microsoft MSCL, because we are going to use MSCL authentication library for getting the access token. So by default, the Microsoft, they also already provide the Microsoft authentication library for JavaScript, for Angular, AngularJS. We are going to use this one. So to use this authentication library, we have to use this endpoint. So they have didn't mention the version here, but the latest current version is v0.2.3. So that's what here we are going to use, and to support the IE and all, we have to use this bluebird.min.js to support the IE. Okay, so I'm going to use here, I have this 0.2.3 for MSCL authentication library, and this 3.3, this is Bluebird for supporting the IE. So I'm copying this and use this HTML. Okay, so here we have four buttons. One is sign in, and then another one is sign out, get all files, which will returns all the files from the OneDrive, and button create folder, which creates a folder in OneDrive. This is what we are going to do it. So on the graph helper, which has these methods, and then which also has a method for authenticating with the authorization server. So I'm going to graph helper. And then here, here they already have the Microsoft authentication for JavaScript library. So they already have some functions. I'm going to use those methods. So here I'm going to rename as my app. Here I'm going to, we have to get this information from client. We have to get a client ID from application config, from the config.js. And then this one is ready. Next one is we have to use two methods for getting authorization, and to get that is ID code token, and another one is another method for getting the access token. So we have to use this thing first. I'm going to function sign in, under the sign in file, if I clicked on sign in, we have to call this the pop-up, which opens the pop-up for getting the concern, and another one is for getting the access token. This returns the access, the first one is returns the code ID token, and next one is returns the access token. We are going to use this access token in our code. Okay, so if because this acquire token silent, sometimes it will not work in IE mode, so that we are using the, once again we are using another method for If the previous one is failed, we are using another method to get the access token. Okay, this is what we are going to use now. And another method is function sign out. Function, okay, here we are going to replace. Okay, and then here this is my default code here. Sign out my app dot log out. Okay, so once we are getting this access token, we are going to store it in a local storage. Local storage dot token equal to access token. This one is ready, and the same way here also we to use same. You are storing the access token in the local storage so that we can use this access token in other request. Okay, and then once we are signed in, we are going to get that current user information. So here I'm get user current user info. We are going to use where URL equal to application config and then graph endpoint. We have said this graph endpoint, we are getting this one. Okay, and by default we have to get the VAS scope also. Graphs scopes application config dot graph scopes. So we have my application. This is authenticated with the MSCIL. It's using the MSCIL library, and we are storing this graph scopes, the permission scope under the graph scopes variable. And then we are going to call, once the sign in button click, we are going to call this methods to get the access token. And then once we get the access token, we are going to call the current user info method. So this will. So this current user info, okay, that's all. Key endpoint, okay. This in the current user info, we are going to pass the HTTP request and get the response back. So, and then where access token equal local storage dot token. Once I am going to copy. That this is a HTTP request we are going to pass. HTTP request, and then we are passing the URL in the XML HTTP open.get. The URL will be this one, graph endpoint. If you check the graph endpoint, this is the by default graph API. So I'm going to graph explorer and show you that one. Developer graph explorer, and then this is a me, and then it will returns you the current user logged in user information. Here I haven't logged in, so that it's displaying some other user information. If I logged in with my account, then run this query, it showed this endpoint. So we are going to get this endpoint from our code. So I'm going to graph Excel, and then once the response is success, we are going to display the user value, user name in the HTML in welcome user. If my name is Santakumar, so it will display welcome Santakumar, and then we are going to hide this button sign in element, and also we are going to enable or enable a visibility on container. The container which shows the sign out button and button get files, button create folder, and then the JSON ID element. So we have whatever the response we are getting, we are going to pass show it in the JSON element, the pre-JSON element. So I'm just saving this and calling this one. So we are going to run this, run our application, and people listening on port 2020. So I'm going to lock. So this is our application, and I'm going to click on sign in. It opens a pop-up, and then we are going to log in. Okay, response type ID token is not enabled for this application, so something is missing. So I'm going back. Client ID auth callback. Happening here. I'm going to app registration portal. JS Graph application ID localhost 2020. Save. Okay, now I'm coming back to our application. Sign in. Okay, there is some mistake. Okay, so I don't know what is happening. Let me check it. Okay, I'm moving back. Call back. I'm checking everything is correct or not. So function graph access token error. Check our config. Let me start once again. I'm first pausing this one, and then first we'll check in the authorize, everything is correct. This is authorize, response type, token scope, user.read, files.read, write, open ID profile, client ID, and then redirect URI host 2020 state. These are the additional information we are passing in the authorize request. So ID token is not enabled, ID token is not okay. Okay, let me go. Okay, this is not working, so let me, maybe we'll get another application ID. So I'm going to JS app 1 to use this client ID. Okay, this is great. I think we can able to authorize this one. So I'll come back with why that is not working in my next session. So in this session, we'll move forward with my previous client ID. Okay, so here in the Graph Explorer, we are pausing the URL here. URL. I'm just sign in. You can see now we have successfully logged in and I'm able to get this button. If I click on this sign out button, it will log out from my application. So it's saying just I'm logging out. So it's good. Yeah, I'm moving back to here. So now we have to run write the code for getting all the files from the OneDrive and creating the folder. Okay, we'll move on to that one. My code is here. So we are going to write button get all files. So we have limited time, so that instead of debugging, I'm moving back to moving forward with another client ID function. Okay, so here also we have to pause. I'm going to use this one. Okay, and then we have to write another method for render our JSON output in the this element. So for that one, I have another one code which will run this. Have an update UI which will get the HTML element and then update our JSON there. So I'm going to use update UI and we have. So I'm going to run once again our application, sign in. Logged in, you can see the render information is visible here. The same JSON for JSON is also visible in this here in the Graph Explorer. So we are going to retrieve the all files first. Now so I'm moving back to my code, get all files. I have already have my code ready here. Here we are going to pass our URL with header as authorization and bearer plus access token and sending the request. Once we retrieve the request, this update UI will be called, and it will update in the pre-element, that JSON ID element. So I'm saving this and then run our application, sign in. I'm going to get all files. Nothing is happening. Wait. Okay, it's not. Yeah, okay. In the button files, we have to update the graph endpoint. So for retrieving all OneDrive files, we have where? Okay, to retrieve all items from the OneDrive, we have to use this graph endpoint. And the for reading all the files from the OneDrive for the current user, we have to use this files.read as a permission scope. So then only if we remove that files.read, we will not get any file information. We will only get the forbidden error. If we specify that files.read permission scope, then only we can able to get the files from the OneDrive. I'm just going to visit our application and refresh this, sign in. Okay, this is a current user information. Click on this, get all files. We are retrieving all the files. This is a folder, attachments is a folder, and then I have demo folder 1 folder, demo folder 2 folder, folder 3 folders, and then demo folder 5, folder 6, notebooks, this is also folder, proposals, this is also a folder under my OneDrive. And this is also folder. Well, these are the folders available in the top level OneDrive folder. Okay, so and then yeah, we also have your files in the top level OneDrive folder. So we are going to create maybe I'm going to create maybe app demo folder. We'll create that one. So moving back to this, our code for creating a new folder, the graph endpoint will be this one, graph microsoft.com me drive root children, and then we have to pass this as a parameter, this folder value, and then we have to use the post request. So I have a code ready. I'm going to close this one. URL will be this. Okay, and the post request authorization content type, we have to pass this one, and then here we have to pass our folder name. So app demo folder. So I'm just once click on that. So once it created it, the status will be 201. So in previously in the get request we'll get only the 200. Now we'll get 201 for creation request, the post request. So I'm refresh this, refresh our site. I'm going to refresh this one, sign in. Then create folder. I think nothing happening. Okay, the okay, URL.
Shanta, I have one query. Can I ask now or should I?
Yeah, just 1 minute. We'll complete this one. Okay.
Yeah, sure. Thank you.
And just sign in. Okay, we'll create a folder now. Yeah, the folder is created, app demo folder. Okay, now we'll retrieve all the get all files, which will retrieve all the folders and files from the top level folder of OneDrive. So here we have app demo folder, and then attachments. So this is what it's a simple thing for authentication. So we can use the same kind of authentication methods in any JavaScript based application, AngularJS, React, so anywhere we can use it. Okay, this is a basic method which will for authorizing with the Microsoft Graph at the Azure AD authorization server. Yeah, that's
Hello.
All from my end. Yeah, you have you asked any question?
Yeah.
Yeah, please.
Ask. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, Harinath, you can go ahead, please.
Actually, when I use when I go with the form-based authentication, can we do the anonymous means custom login page using REST API or also any client-side update mode?
Okay, where you are using form-based authentication in the SharePoint online?
No, on-premise.
Okay, currently this Graph API will work on SharePoint online only. That is a Microsoft Cloud environment only. So I think at present they have didn't enable this endpoint to retreat from on-premise environment, because what are the data, what are the resources available in the Microsoft Cloud, that only this Graph API will fetch.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hey, Santa. This is Manoj. So,
yeah.
Santa, actually, I joined late quite. So, I thought this session is going to start on 7 o'clock. So, just now I saw the message on C-Sharp Corner. It's shifted to the 5:30. So, I missed a couple of things. So I'll request if I get all the videos.
Yeah, sure.
Recording.
So, we have recording. So, in my, I have the previous session recording also with me, but the voice is not clear. So, I'm just re recording that one. So I'll also upload that second session video as well as this session video as well.
Sure.
Okay,
thanks. So I have one question there.
Yeah.
So when we're using this Graph APIs, right, every time when we are generating the access token, so it's using the client ID and the user's ID, not the password, right, for generating the token?
No, not the password, right. It's only, I have, yeah, this authorization
okay.
will retrieve, we are pausing this scope. Scope is a user dot permission. Okay.
Correct.
This
correct.
One.
Yeah.
And then client ID. So when we are using the client secret, it's in service based. That is if the application will use the application permission scope. Okay. I already told there are two types of permission permissions are there. One is delegated and another one is application. Application means the application permission will run on the timer jobs or the services. So it's the background process. So there, maybe we can use this client ID and secret.
So this
okay.
client ID is related where we are generating. It's Azure AD we are generating and giving the permission.
Yeah, in application portal itself, we'll be generating that one. So let me go to my apps.
Yeah, please. Might be you covered. I missed
no,
that.
No. This is the client secret. Okay.
Okay.
So, this once I go to my any application here. Here you can see generate new password. Okay. So
okay. Got it.
This so we can able to see this password only once. So once during the creation itself, we have to copy it and store it somewhere else.
So it means this client ID password is having a delegate access to my Graph API. If I use this client ID and client secret, so on behalf of any users, if I hit the API with the particular person's email address, I can get all information, right?
Yeah, that's what we can get all set of. That is, if you are using that app, okay, that's if that app is using the delegated permissions, okay, whenever you have... Okay, without the Graph API, if you are able to access other user, that is other user inbox or other user information or other user other user restricted files, if you have access, okay, without using Graph, okay, if you have access by default, you can able to access via Graph API. So if you are not able to access other user information in a browser, it's a browser. The same way, you should not access those information through Graph API. If you have access via the client, that is browser, then only you can able to access those resources through the Graph API endpoint. Okay.
Access means
I'll show you one example. Wait, I'll show you an example. Yeah. Oh, let me open my Node.js graph. Which one? Okay, here I have let me open. This is not okay. Let me first run our code. npm start. Okay.
So in the meantime, just one thing. Can see every time when we hit the graph, we need to sign in. Can we avoid this sign in process? So the question I asked
that is, if we store our information or access token is available for some time, it won't expire by initially. Okay, so before that is because currently we are referencing, we are updating the code and then recompiling our code so that it is asking us to attend login every time. Okay, if you are using the application seamlessly without any modification, you can use as same as it is. You don't need to log in multiple times. Okay, so currently I'm going to log in with admin access. Okay. Admin at sorry, let me go with I'm going to log in with this one. Okay, currently I'm logging as admin access, so I'm able to access every information. So first I'm going to SharePoint site, so I'm able to view all the SharePoint information, whatever I'm seeing here. Okay, these are all the site collections and subsites available in my Office 65 tenant. Okay, so myself is a admin, so I'm going to log in with another sample user. Okay, who doesn't access to all SharePoint sites. Connect to Microsoft Graph. I use another account.
So this activity we can avoid, as we discussed. If you're using the access token and pass this user's email address and generate access new access token based on client ID, then we can skip this authentication for other users also. If we need to do something for elevations in our applications, right?
Right. So that is if you are going with client ID and secret, we can skip this authorization, okay, authentication. But if you are going to something has happened local. I don't know. Okay, here itself we can disconnect and re-log in. Connect to
maybe
I don't know. So. This user doesn't have access to the top level SharePoint site. Okay, so we are going to use the same code, but he will get the output differently. So I'm going to SharePoint site. You can see only the five sites he can able to view. So this user has access to these only five SharePoint sites, but the admin have access to all SharePoint sites. Even though this particular code is showing the same code we are using for the both user, so if the user have access to that particular resource, he can able to view it. If that user doesn't have access to particular resource, that user doesn't able to visit.
Okay.
You understand? Got it? Or,
no, that's fine. Only the things I was just thinking, if we can skip the authentication process So that particular user who is logging again and again, so we just
create that we can see it, skip it, because if the user is, he has stored his username and password in the browser, and that is it asking, no, so if the user authentication is stored in a cache, that user doesn't need to re-log in every time. Got it?
No, not so, for re-login purpose. So if I created any web application which is running on the web app and I want to consume this graph API and the admin is going to create, it just like any simple examples will take send in or like when I need a graph API, need to consume, and but I don't want user credential who has logged in. I want to do something on behalf of someone else. So don't access token currently generated for me. I use client ID, client secret, and my token, what is auth token is generated, and behalf of that I'm doing. But I want to do for other users also. It just not like illegal thing, but yeah, I want to do for other users. But for other users, what I have just the email address for the users. Okay. So can I do for
that one? You have to use the client ID and secret. Okay. Yeah. So yes, you have to run.
It will work.
Okay. So here elevation will work.
Yeah, it will work.
Okay.
Maybe
Thanks.
If you maybe we can discuss this on offline. So okay. So maybe if you have so any other question? Yeah.
So did you get a chance to create using the native code like C# code? So to get the response type code, whatever the code is generating, right?
Yeah, for C# also we have that MACL library. The same methods is available for that C# also. So we can what are the things we are doing in now? The same thing we can also achieve it by using C#. For the C# we have
I have tried with C# to create Microsoft Teams.
Okay.
So I'm unable to create using the application credential. But it works with the delegated credential, like a username and password. So, I'm facing the issue to generate that response type code. I'm able to generate in Postman, but the same when I try to create using the C# with a running a scheduler kind of job to create the teams. So I'm facing that response type of code to generate.
Okay, for application permitting, that in the application registration portal, we have to select the appropriate permissions. Maybe some permissions you have missed.
I have given the grant type, selecting the Microsoft API, Microsoft Graph API. Then I given the permission to read and write all the groups and all. So all the I have selected all the and granted the permissions. So even though I'm able to generate in Postman.
Okay.
And when I pass that Postman response type code to create a team, so it is successfully working and it is creating the team. The same when I replicate in the C# code, so then I'm facing that to generate the response type code, it is not able to generate only. So that's the reason.
Okay. Maybe maybe I have to just look into the code that how you are using that in your C# application, then only I can able to tell it. Maybe we can see that
connect offline and
we will connect that in offline.
Code to
you. Okay.
Yeah, thanks, buddy. Thanks a lot.
Yeah. So I think someone is asking the source code.
So, go ahead. How you got the access token? Access token you got from C# and then put it in the Postman and then running your APIs, right?
Yeah, either the both way we can use. You can generate from the Postman also access token. You can generate the authorization code, barrier authorization code, whatever that you can pass that one and you can generate that one.
So okay.
Authorization
code. Okay, so I tried in the same way what Shanta is saying. Apart from that, what I tried the same thing. I created the Azure Active Directory and grant the access to Azure Active Directory to the so the Graph API to the Azure Active Directory, and then use that client ID, client secret, and give the permissions as a scope to that one. Then in code, I use all means it's worked actually. MSIL identity.
For which app you are trying for, like OneDrive or Team or which one?
I just want to fetch the detail of the APIs for, especially of the meeting invites. I was just fetching all the particular users. So that one I tried.
We can connect offline. I can check that, whatever.
Yeah, that's what I will connect offline and maybe in.
To you. You can go through Microsoft Graph API. They provided that by the NuGet package.
Okay. Hi guys, I think another session is going to start in 3 minutes, so I think we have to wind up. Maybe if you have any question, you can post me, or you can just mail me, or you can just ping me in any LinkedIn, the Twitter, Facebook, in the name of KTS Kumar. Okay, so we'll connect in the offline if you have any doubts. Okay, so maybe in we plan to have another one session maybe in next month. Okay, we'll update you soon. Thank you, everyone. Thanks for joining.